Водка, водка. Водка, водка, нет. Смирнов, водка. Яков. Яков, нет, нет, нет. Potato, водка, водка, водка. Нет, 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 нет. Смирнов, водка.
This bitch.
Another Vladimir once said, there are decades where nothing happens, and there are weeks where decades happen. And with that, I welcome you all to Cold War II! Will Cold War II be better than Cold War I? Probably not! Sequels always suck ass.
I have been trying to get this video done since before Russia invaded Ukraine. But since this thing developed so fast, and since I'm in school, I haven't had the time to finish this shit. But now that I'm on break, and we're over 100 days into this conflict, and emotions have died down, why don't we fully examine this? Yeah? Let's get it.
After spending years issuing legitimate grievances over the expansion of NATO, and then upon betraying those reasonable grievances by offering a batshit revisionist history of Russia and Ukraine, Vladimir Putin has thrown the entire world into a tizzy. His invasion of Ukraine is an attempt at upsetting the established order, and with it, he has ushered in a new geopolitical era. He's also succeeded in stressing out nearly every human on the planet.
I found my thrill on Blueberry Hill.
No more Mr. Nice Putin singing Blueberry Hill. We're dealing with Fuck the West Forever Putin now.
Also,
COVID? What the fuck is that?
If you thought you had a rough pandemic, just look at Putin's recent taste in furniture. COVID obviously made him a little stir crazy, and now he thinks he's the heir to Peter the Great. Now we all know he ain't the heir to shit, and normally we would tell despots like him to fuck off, but we can't really do that because he has several thousands of these. And that is what makes this whole NATO shit so stressful. Lots of people I know would say that history is boring, but it's not. It's illuminating, it's fascinating, and it's a warning. Lord help us, because we failed to rethink NATO after the fall of the Soviet Union, we have now locked ourselves into a World War I-like alliance system. Because if Russia attacks any NATO country, then all of NATO has to respond, and then we're in full-blown World War III, which will probably turn nuclear. And if that doesn't cure your constipation, I don't know what will.
I think now would be a good time to give a rundown on NATO. NATO is short for the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. It's an intergovernmental military alliance among 28 European countries and two North American countries. It was set up in the aftermath of World War II, and its main purpose was to act as a deterrent against the increasing influence of the Soviet Union. Now you may say, Daniel, the Soviet Union is no more. Why is NATO still a thing? That's a great fucking question. Back in 1990, when the wall came down and Germany reunified, there was an agreement between Russia and the United States that said a lot of the Eastern European countries that bordered Russia would not join NATO. This was merely a verbal agreement. No treaty was ever written up. The promise to deny Eastern European countries entry into NATO was done to appease the collapsed USSR. You see, America had won the Cold War, and they didn't want to rub it in the face of the Ruskies. Being a sore winner is a surefire way of fucking up global political resolutions. And so, with the verbal agreement made, the United States has since kept their promise in not allowing several Eastern European countries entry into NATO. Wrong! Wrong!
George Kennan is rolling over in his grave right now. The Czech Republic, Hungary, and Poland were admitted into NATO in 1999. In 2002, these countries joined NATO. In 2008, Ukraine and Georgia were formally invited into NATO, and that led to some pew-pew in Georgia.
This year, we let Finland and Sweden into NATO. Without any real debate, really. It was kind of unanimous. And now Stockholm and Helsinki have Article 5 nuclear protection. Whee! I don't doubt that 20 years of slowly crowding Putin has made him a wee paranoid. Hell, he wouldn't be a Russian leader if he weren't dangerously paranoid. The NATO aspect of this affair is a detail that could justify Putin's invasion of Ukraine. Think of it in this way. If Russia put nuclear missiles in Mexico, you don't think we'd have a problem with that? Hell, we had a problem with it back in the 60s when we found out the Soviets were putting missiles in Cuba. Remember that? The Cuban Missile Crisis? I feel like we're living in the spiritual successor of that moment. I fucking hate it. When Putin invaded Ukraine and the rest of the world cried out why, all he needed to do was stand up and point to NATO. And when we, the United States, cried out, you can't invade another sovereign nation, all he'd need to do then was point to Iraq. And then that's what would give us good reason to shut the fuck up globally. But he didn't do that. Instead, he went on about how Lenin had made a mistake in giving up Ukraine. And then that's when you knew, oh yeah, this guy's just high on his own Russian revanchism supply. What could have been marketed as a war of necessity was clearly identified as a war of choice. And if you don't know what a war of choice is, think of it as a giant war crime. And when you take off the lid, you'll find thousands of little war crimes inside. Because of the NATO alliance and Russia's rhetoric, there are so many tripwires around this whole Ukraine shit. If any NATO country sends in any soldiers to back up the Ukrainian forces, tripwire pulled, World War III. If any Russian bomb lands anywhere in Poland, tripwire pulled. If Putin interprets all of the aid that these EU and NATO countries are sending Ukraine as participation in the armed conflict, tripwire pulled. If a NATO-enforced no-fly zone is enacted over Ukraine, tripwire pulled. I've been screaming about people wanting to enact no-fly zones and how stupid that is for days now. And we have to know. We have to know everything. We need to know exactly what enacting a no-fly zone means. We have to know and understand Russian military doctrine. Here in America, even though we were psychos and dropped 2 A-bombs on Japan, when it comes to nuclear weapons, we say,
this is my last resort!
The Russians don't see nuclear weapons the same. They see them as super artillery. The Russians have a strategy where if they need to clear a battlefield, they will consider using nuclear bombs to clear it and then having their troops move through the nuclear wasteland onto whatever target they're marching towards. They're crazy, man. It's fucking crazy. We gotta know and understand what they're thinking and saying. That's why us banning their media is a terrible idea. How are we going to know how they're feeling and how to act accordingly if we ban all of their shit? And we got to know and understand the consequences of these sanctions that we're laying on them. We really backed Putin into a corner with these fucking sanctions. We sanctioned Russia's bank and we banned their oil. We did the whole shebang to them economically. And now if things escalate even more, there's nothing else for us to do except go to war with them. Also, those sanctions aren't even fucking working. Oil prices are so high right now, Russia is making money hand over fist selling oil to China and India at a discount. We wanted to cripple Putin's war machine? Well, that war machine is flush with cash and chugga 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 chugging right along. And we might have banned their oil, but we're still buying it. The Indians are selling it to us, but at a markup. So we're still buying their oil and paying more money for it. And you think it's bad here in America? It's much worse over there in Europe. There are so many countries that are so dependent on Russian natural gas. Putin has all of those countries by the balls. It's gonna be a long, cold winter in Europe this year. While the sanctions aren't the only reason why inflation and gas prices are high, they sure don't fucking help. And the ruble? Is doing gangbusters right now. It's performing incredibly well. The only people we have sanctioned is ourselves. Congratulations, America. You sanctioned yourself.
I hope you guys are starting to understand the gravity of this situation, because you know who doesn't? The establishment and the mainstream media.
I hear you on that, but those images are heartbreaking to watch. We see innocent civilians being killed. We see children being killed, and the administration has made it clear there will be no boots on the ground. What will it take? Will anything change that? Will we stand by and watch innocent people continue to be killed here?
Look what they're doing to Mariupol. Look what they're doing. They're attacking civilians. How long is NATO going to sit back and watch Russia intentionally target civilians?
You're suicidal. Why? In the early days of the invasion, shit like this pissed me the fuck off. You got jokers like Gayle King and Chuck Todd asking questions like,
administration has made it clear there will be no boots on the ground. What will it take? Will anything change that?
And
how long is NATO going to sit back and watch Russia intentionally target civilians?
I wish I can go on their stupid fucking shows and ask them, and then what? And then what? And then what, Gayle King? What happens after we put boots on the ground? Oops! World War III? You want NATO to intervene, Chuck? All right. And then what? And then what? The minute these unbiased reporters start acting on their emotions and start trying to appeal to yours, they cease being journalists. And that's when you have to stop listening to them. Change the fucking channel. These guys are partisan clowns. The only reason why Gayle King is famous is because she's friends with Oprah. The only reason why Chuck Todd has a show is because he has a PhD in liberal ass kissing. If you take anything these ignorant fools say into consideration, then you will be led into the oblivion they're calling for.
You know, if we can see on satellite imagery where the convoy is, I don't know, maybe some smart country, maybe NATO might take some of their fighter jets, or maybe they can use some drone strikes and take out the whole damn convoy. And then nobody takes credit for it. So then Putin won't know who to hit back. Well, he's threatening nuclear weapons. Hannity, you're talking about nuclear war. I'm not talking about nuclear war, nor would I support one American boot on the ground here.
It should be illegal for somebody this stupid to have a TV show or a podcast or what have you. Somebody give Sean Hannity a fucking helmet.
Do you still stand by your call to have Putin be assassinated? Do you still stand by your
call? Yeah, I hope he'll be taken out. One way or the other. I don't care how they take him out. I don't care if we send him to The Hague and try him. I just want him to go. Yes, I'm on record. Please understand, Senator Lindsey Graham, if John McCain were here, he'd be saying the same thing, I think. It's time for him to go. He's a war criminal. Vladimir Putin is not a legitimate leader. He is a war criminal. He needs to be dealt with by the Russian people. I'm not asking to invade Russia to take him out. I'm not asking to send American ground forces in Ukraine to fight the Russian army. I am asking the Russian people to rise up and end this reign of terror for you and the world at large.
Thank you, Lady G, for all of those juicy sound bites Putin could use in his propaganda over there in Russia.
And while I'm on the subject of the Russian people, let me just say, at the onset of the Ukrainian invasion, the fact that we banned their vodka, their athletes, the fact that people wanted to expel Russian students from American universities, and a whole bunch of other things, that was stupid. Incredibly stupid and xenophobic. I'm surprised nobody suggested building internment camps. Why are we going to demonize, denounce, ostracize, and ultimately punish regular-ass Russians? Our beef isn't with them. Our beef is with Putin. The Russian people were just as surprised as we were when Putin sent troops into Ukraine. The banning, the bad-mouthing, and the sanctioning only strengthens Putin's hand at home. Putin's telling the people of Russia that the West wants to destroy them and their way of life. Tell me, what have we done to prove that otherwise? Anyway, back to this elected dolt.
I don't think Lindsey Graham knows, or maybe he does and he doesn't care, but under Russian military doctrine, if a state official calls for regime change in Russia, that gives Russia grounds to declare war on the state that official is from. But maybe the folks over there at the Kremlin were able to deduce, much like us here in America, that Lindsey Graham is a fucking idiot. You know who else the Kremlin probably realized was a fucking idiot? The president.
For free people refused to live in a world of hopelessness and darkness. We will have a different future, a brighter future, rooted in democracy and principle, hope and light, of decency and dignity, of freedom and possibilities. For God's sake, this man cannot remain power.
For those of you Americans watching this, tell me, how does it feel to watch your president say this?
For God's sake, this man cannot remain power.
And then have his administration immediately walk that back. In the face of possible nuclear war, having this schizophrenic messaging is exactly what we need. Because after all, the words of a president do matter, right? I think I'm pulling a Sleepy Joe here because I can't remember who said that.
Look, the words of a president matter, no matter how good or bad that president is.
And while it makes me really nervous to have Putin as the leader of Russia, I just want to ask the Biden administration, do you guys really think his replacement will be any better? You guys really think you can get a guy who's less hawkish? Like, what do you guys expect to happen? The GRU are gonna knock off Putin and replace him with Barney the fucking dinosaur? If Sleepy Joe really thinks that this is going to happen, then I can only describe the president by using his own words.
What a stupid son of a bitch.
I think President Biden's leadership has been steady and constructive, but this is a critical moment. If Vladimir Putin, who has shown us how brutal he can be, is allowed to just continue to massacre civilians, to commit war crimes throughout Ukraine without NATO, without the West coming more forcefully to his aid, I deeply worry that what's going to happen next is that we will see Ukraine turn into Syria. Mm-hmm. The American people cannot turn away from this tragedy in Ukraine. I think the history of the 21st century turns on how fiercely mm-hmm. we defend freedom in Ukraine, and that Putin will only stop when we stop him.
He will stop only when we stop him? Well, fuck Senator Chris Coons, old Biden whisperer in the Senate. If you want to stop Putin so bad, why don't you lace up a pair of boots and go fucking stop him? Why don't you have your own children lace up a pair of boots and go protect freedom and democracy in Ukraine? See, we both know that's not gonna happen. If we do send troops over there, it's not going to be you or anybody you know, Senator Coons. It's going to be regular-ass Americans that have no business or care going over there. Your cowardice and foolishness knows no bounds, Senator, you mealy-mouthed motherfucker.
The Russians invaded Afghanistan back in 1980. And although no country went in, they certainly had a lot of countries supplying arms and advice and even some advisors to those who were recruited to fight Russia. It didn't end well for the Russians. There were other unintended consequences, as we know. But the fact is that a very motivated and then funded and armed insurgency basically drove the Russians out of Afghanistan. But I think that is the model that people are now looking toward. And if there can be sufficient armaments that get in, and they should be able to get in along some of the borders between other nations and Ukraine, and keep the Ukrainian, both their military and their citizen volunteer soldiers supplied, That can continue to stymie Russia.
The insurgency that Hillary's talking about that fought the Russians back in the 1980s were the Mujahideen. You can consider them the pre-evolved form of these guys. Yeah, let's give the fucking Nazis some guns. Let's see what monstrosity they turn into in 10 years. And when Hillary says, with a smile,
there were other unintended consequences, as we know.
She's talking about this.
Coming from south to north, I watched the plane fly into the World Trade Center.
This is a very evil move on the part of Vladimir Putin. He's a KGB guy who happens to be probably the richest man in the world because of his exploitation of his own people that he doesn't want them to know about, and uses excuses like, it's changed. Every time you hear him say, well, they're part of us, that's who we are, they should be us. Now they're saying, well, we have to go in because they want to be part of NATO. This, my friends, is our moment. This is the Sudetenland. That's what people were saying there.
No, it's not.
And when I look at what's happening, our country is like, it's run by fools. When you see that they don't even want to stop, we're paying, figure this, we're fighting Russia, we're watching a Holocaust. Well,
that's not true either. A lot of people are trying to equate Putin to Hitler, and that's just not the case. Hitler was a genocidal maniac bent on world domination. Putin just wants to shore up his borders, and it seems he doesn't care if it comes at another country's expense. If Putin had the same type of ambitions Hitler had, then this video would have a whole different flavor.
Now with the Russians marching in, it's changed the calculus entirely. Tens of thousands of people have tried to flee the city. There will be many more. People are hiding out in bomb shelters. But this isn't a place, with all due respect, like Iraq or Afghanistan, that has seen conflict raging for decades. You know, this is a relatively civilized, relatively European, I have to choose those words carefully too, city where you wouldn't expect that or hope that it's going to happen. So it's partly human nature, but they are not in denial.
Me, I'm sorry, it's really emotional for me because I see European people with blue eyes and blonde hair being killed, children being killed every day with Putin's missiles and his helicopters and his rockets.
And so, of course, I understand and respect the emotion. What you are outlining there is this tension between longer-term efforts to apply pressure to Vladimir Putin, such as financial sanctions, and the very immediate military threat which you're experiencing.
Now the unthinkable has happened to them. And this is not a developing third-world nation. This is Europe.
These three really give away the plot, don't they? Oh my God, they're killing white people! No! The mainstream media should cover the war that's going on in Ukraine because of the catastrophic consequences it could reap, but they never show this much energy when it comes to other crises in the world. What about what's happening in the Congo? Did you know that something's happening in the Congo? Because I didn't know until several months ago. What about the civil war in Yemen? Nobody's talking about fucking Yemen, but that place is a goddamn mess. Hundreds of thousands of people have died in Yemen. There's an ongoing famine, but we don't say shit about it because the Saudis are bombing the shit out of that place, and who's giving them the missiles? We are. When it comes to these conflicts, mum's the word from these clowns, but oh my God, they start killing blonde-haired and blue-eyed people. World War III, right now.
So there's been a nuclear attack. Don't ask me how or why, just know that the big one has hit, okay? So what do we do?
I'm sorry, I told myself I wasn't gonna stop the video, but I have to because what the fuck do you mean, don't ask you how or why?
There are three important steps that I want you to remember. Step one, get inside fast. You, your friends, your family, get inside. And no, staying in the car is not an option. You need to get into a building and move away from the windows. Step two, stay inside. Shut all doors and windows. Have a basement? Head there. If you don't have one, get as far into the middle of the building as possible. If you were outside after the blast, get clean immediately. remove and bag all outer clothing to keep radioactive dust or ash away from your body. Step 3, stay tuned. Follow media for more information. Don't forget to sign up for Notify NYC for official alerts and updates. And don't go outside until officials say it's safe. All right, you've got this.
Who made this video, Vault Tech? This PCA is stupid. This PCA is cope. Here is the God-honest truth. If you live in New York or other cities like Washington, D.C. and Los Angeles, if there is a nuclear blast, y'all are getting vaporized, okay? And you better hope you get vaporized, because I gotta tell you folks, Fallout is a very fun game. I don't want to live in it though, but don't worry.
You've got this.
I'd like to point out that these guys are starting to be more like this. And while we should be worried about this fool, we should maybe be more worried about this fool. Because this guy is looking to make some moves in the near future. In November of this year, Xi Jinping, Winnie the Pooh, is looking to enter his third term as the President of the People's Republic of China. And he's looking to make this one permanent. This guy's goal in life is to make China the number one power in the world. And right now, there's some internal problems going on in his country that's testing this. All I gotta say is that if you're putting tanks in front of banks to prevent people from withdrawing their money, your country ain't doing so hot. I like how that's China's solution for everything. What? There's a housing crisis? Send in the tanks! Xi Jinping, Winnie the Pooh, is getting a little antsy, and that's why events like Cuntface over here going needlessly to Taiwan just to satisfy her own ego are getting his panties in a bunch. I don't think you guys understand how bad of an idea it was for Nancy Pelosi to go to Taiwan. Because of old stock trader extraordinaire Pelosi's reckless, dangerous trip to Taiwan, intelligence sources say that Xi Jinping, Winnie the Pooh, is looking to expedite his invasion of Taiwan, and that it may happen within the next 18 months. And now I'm talking about Taiwan. Ukraine, Taiwan. If I'm gonna keep rambling on about this shit, I might as well look you guys in the eye.
All right.
Tell me, was gas reaching $5 nationally enough for you guys? You guys ready to put away those Ukrainian flags? The next 10 years are probably going to be very, very scary. And that's why we should be very, very smart as we can be. That's why I think it's within our best interests that we wrap this war in Ukraine up as fast as we can. Let's go for a negotiated settlement. Now that might be hard to come by, probably impossible at this moment, but if we keep trying to have these peace talks, eventually, who knows, we might have some fucking peace. It won't hurt to try, okay? The longer this war goes on, the less safe we all are globally. Ukraine is known as the breadbasket of Europe. It has that name for a reason. It supplies a whole bunch of countries with grain. With the war going on, that grain isn't going out, and it's sparking a global famine. And why don't we just call it what it is? This conflict in Ukraine is just a proxy war. It's a proxy war between America and Russia. Two nuclear powers. And if two nuclear powers are fighting each other, well then, if they keep on fighting, they might actually launch those nukes. I hate to beat a dead horse, but I'm afraid I won't have any dead horses to beat because they'll all be vaporized soon. I feel for the Ukrainians, I really do. If I were in their position, I would probably want to fight till the bitter end. But the fact that they can't bankroll their own defense means that the Russians are probably going to outlast them and win this war of attrition. I hate to say it, but that seems like the most possible outcome. And I know everyone right now is in love with Zelensky. He's this heroic guy, but I'll just say it, he's a little shady too, okay? He's banned opposition parties in his country. He's fired his two high-ranking intel officers. Apparently, all of the guns and weapons that we're giving him, he's losing track of those. And people in Europe right now are kind of worried where those guns are going. It would be a shame if they ended up in the hands of the Nazis that are in Ukraine right now. I think that would be really bad. Also, the White House itself doesn't really trust Zelensky. So why are we sending him so much money? But Joe Biden is devoted to this. He said so.
How long is it fair to expect American drivers and drivers around the world to pay that premium for this war?
As long as it takes, so Russia cannot, in fact, defeat Ukraine and move beyond Ukraine.
And he's forcing you to be as devoted as he is. Now tell me, are you really that devoted? You're telling me you can send $55 billion and then some to Ukraine, but you can't send me another $2,000 stimmy? The fuck, Joe Biden? And just because I think Zelensky is sus, and I'm mad at him for asking for a fly zone 15 fucking times, that doesn't mean I'm a Vladimir Putin stan. Fuck Vladimir Putin. I think he's a dictator, I think he's a butcher, and I think he royally fucked up with his whole invasion thing. What did Vladimir Putin want? He wanted NATO away from his doorstep, and he wanted a divided West. What happened when he sent troops into Ukraine? Well, he unified all of the West against him, and NATO is so close to his doorstep that he could see them through his Ring camera. Ukraine is Putin's Iraq. You break, you buy. Even if we don't help Ukraine, Putin's probably going to have an insurgency on his hand that's going to last for years. It's going to bleed him and Russia dry. And, you know, if he ends up taking Ukraine, that's a country of 44 million. And all of those people, or a good majority of those people, hate the motherfucker. So, good luck trying to keep that all together, comrade. It's also becoming very clear that Ukraine is Act One in this whole Cold War II thing. Taiwan seems to be Act Two, and oh my god, is that gonna suck. China has made it no secret that they want Taiwan back in the fold, and they're not gonna let anybody try and stop them. Thing is, though, there's gonna be a lot of people that are gonna try and stop them. China has never been in a position where they could take Taiwan, but because of globalization, that's not the case anymore. If China makes a play for Taiwan, then the United States is going to get roped in, Japan's going to get roped in, Australia's going to get roped in, South Korea's going to rope, I legitimately don't even want to think about it. If there's a war with China, and it ends up that China takes Taiwan, well, then that would tank the American economy instantly, because Taiwan makes a good majority of the world's semiconductors. These are the chips that are in every single device that you own. Now, I'm not saying we should go to war with China so we can protect our semiconductor factories over there in Taiwan. That's not what I want. I want no war in general at all. I think what we should do is stave off this conflict for as long as we can, and then, I don't know, make semiconductors here in America? I don't know, it doesn't really seem smart to have all of these really important components made in a highly contested island out in the Pacific. I think that's what you call really stupid. I guess it's a good thing that we got some legislation through that's going to encourage the production of semiconductors here in America. I just wish they would have done this 10 years ago, because that's how long it takes to get one of these fucking semiconductor factories online. Thank you, neoliberals. Shipping all of this production overseas was such a good idea. Fuck you! I'd also like to point out that the Chinese do have a lot of these. Not as much as the Russians, but they got a stash. My general assessment of all of this is Cold War II sucks. We need to avoid World War III. Fuck that. Fuck everything. And fuck this video. all I see on every side of this issue, whether it's Ukraine or Taiwan, it's just escalation. And we need to stop escalating because everybody has nukes and sooner or later something's going to happen. We're going to have a misunderstanding or a conflict that we can't back down from, or that people think that we can't back down from. And then it's going to be a fallout. The game Fallout. We're going to be living in the game Fallout for the next hundreds of years. We should be pursuing peace at every avenue. I know peace is not really popular and it's not really profitable, but it's the best for everyone. Okay? I know you may have a lot of questions. I've got a lot of questions. I don't know how long this is going to last. I don't know what the plan is. But one thing I do really want to know. What's so funny about this?